I've just tested the first LCD display that can rival OLED and even surpass it in certain areas. Hello everyone, my name is Vincent Teo. I'm a TV reviewer and professional calibrator. And this small display beside me is Sony's new BVM-HX310 mastering monitor. It's the successor to the BVM-X300, which I basically over when I reviewed it almost 2 years ago. There's one major difference between the two reference monitors. The X300 is a true RGB OLED, whereas this HX310 actually uses LCD technology, although an innovative one. If you have watched some of our previous videos, or followed any online debates on LCD versus OLED, you will know that OLED is self-emissive, meaning that every pixel can be switched on or off independently of adjacent pixels, contributing to true blacks and insanely high contrast ratio. LCD, on the other hand, is transmissive. In essence, the backlight is on at all times. Even when trying to generate black, the liquid crystals would simply be twisted to block light. Some LED LCD TVs with full area local dimming or FALD can switch off the backlight in zones, allowing for higher contrast performance. But it's difficult to avoid blooming or hollowing artifacts when there's light leakage from a zone that's switched on to an adjacent zone that's switched off. Also, when it comes to displaying star fields, which is so challenging because each star is generally smaller in size than the dimming zones, OLED would always win against LED LCD, at least until now. We don't have a BVM-X300 in our test room right now for side-by-side comparison. I'm not sure my insurance company has been too happy covering me taking in one £30,000 display, let alone two. But at least we still have the Panasonic GZ950 here, which is one of the best consumer OLED television you can buy on the market in 2019, albeit a WRGB one. In this starfield pattern from the Spears & Munsell UHD HDR benchmark disc, the stars on the Sony HX310 looked as punchy as on the Panasonic GZ950, with the black background just very, very marginally brighter when scrutinized in a pitch black room. We then checked out this scene from the 4K Blu-ray of Batman vs Superman. Even on the best full array local dimming LED LCDs, the bright lights would cause some blooming artifacts into the top and bottom letterbox bars, but there's just no blooming whatsoever on the HX310. We watched many different scenes, dark ones, mid-bright ones, bright ones, and each time we experienced the same pop and depth we've come to associate with OLED. You know that margarine called I Can't Believe It's Not Butter. Looking at the blacks and contrast put out by the Sony HX310, I can't believe it's not OLED. So how has Sony achieved this level of contrast performance from an LCD? Actually, the technology came from Panasonic's LCD panel manufacturing division. Conventional LCD displays consist of a backlight and a display cell layer, but what Panasonic has done is to add another monochrome cell layer between the backlight and the display cell layer, which can independently control the intensity of backlight entering the display cell layer in a pixel-by-pixel manner. Because of the addition of a second layer, this new LCD technique is commonly called dual-layer LCD, though some purists prefer the more technically correct term of light-modulating cell layer or LMCL. Between you and me, I'm sure we already know which name will catch on. The Hisense U9, which has started selling in China, as well as the upcoming Apple Pro Display XDR 6K monitor are using dual-layer LCD technology, although I understand their panels are not from Panasonic. As you can see from this macro photo of the subpixel structure on the Sony BVM-HX310, the LCD panel type is IPS, and we know that IPS panels generally have a static contrast ratio of 1000 to 1. So the base monochrome light-modulating cell layer is 1000 to 1. The top color display cell layer is 1000 to 1. Multiply these two figures and you get a contrast ratio of 1 million to 1, which is what Sony has specified for the BVM-HX310. Let's go through some other specifications for this reference broadcast monitor. It's a 31-inch screen, in case you are wondering what the numbers 3 and 1 in HX310 represents. The monitor has a true 4K resolution of 1496x2160 pixels, which means that there will be black borders running down both sides when displaying 16:9 content. The front button and user interfaces are very similar to that on the X300, so for seasoned X300 users, it should be a straightforward switch to the HX310. A pair of handles stick out from the rear, and on the very thick chassis, there are some fans which kick into overdrive when in HDR mode, so there will be a significant increase in fan noise once you select an HDR electro-optical transfer function or EOTF from the user menu. There are SDI connections that support up to 12 gigabits per second, and an HDMI input with HDCP 2.3 compliance. The Sony BVM-HX310 will cost you at least £30,000, but at least you get the stand included in the price. Let's talk some hard numbers then. In SDR mode, black level measured 0.004 nits on a 4x4 ANSI checkerboard pattern, which for all intents and purposes is as good as black, although if you put the HX310 side by side against an OLED in a pitch black room, wait a while, you'll see a very faint glow on the HX310 due to our pupil's dark adaptation. In HDR mode, black level doubled to 0.008 nits, which is still unheard of for an LCD display. Remember, this is the native black level of the monitor, which can be maintained even right next to another pixel that's outputting 1000 nits. Yes, the Sony HX310 is capable of delivering a peak brightness of 1000 nits, and because it is not an OLED and therefore isn't restricted by ABL or automatic brightness limiter, it can actually produce 1000 nits full screen. As a result, high APL HDR scenes, such as this one from the 4K Blu-ray of The Matrix, will look brighter and more impactful on the HX310 than any other OLED, including the X300 or the Panasonic GZ950. Colorimetry is reference level, rightly so, for a £30,000 Grade 1 monitor. As you can see from this challenging color checker SG chart where 140 color patches were measured, our Sony HX310 review unit returned an average delta error of below 0.5 after 2-point white balance calibration, without even the most critical colorist would have any complaints. Judging from the narrow red peak in the spectral power of distribution graph captured by our Jetty 1511 spectral radiometer, the backlight uses PFS phosphor, and so could be easier for other client reference televisions to match than the X300 RGB OLED. For HDR, DCI-P3 gamut coverage measured 99% with stunningly accurate color tracking, and there is a useful gamut marker function on the monitor which allows you to see which colors in the input video signal sit outside BT709 or DCI-P3 color gamut. These are indicated by zebra patterns in relevant areas of the picture. If I have time, I'll do another video to show you how often colors exceed the P3 gamut across a handful of 4K Blu-rays I managed to run on the HX310. You can select different transfer functions on the monitor including PQ, HLG and S-Log, and for HDR10 mastering, PQ EOTF tracking was bang on up to 1000 nits. These measurements were actually taken on full field patterns, just to drive home our earlier point about the absence of luminance loading or ABL on this monitor, which is a major advantage compared with the X300 OLED monitor. Viewing angles naturally couldn't compete with OLED, especially given the dual stacked LCD design. We noticed a yellow tint and a drop in contrast beyond 30 degrees off center. So colorists should make sure that their clients sit or stand directly in front of the monitor before accepting their feedback on the grade. And if you're a big shot colorist, before you even contemplate accepting your client's feedback on the grade. The HX310 doesn't do any tone mapping and so will clip any specular highlight detail above 1000 nits, such as the sun and surrounding clouds in the scene from Pan, which is mastered to 4000 nits. This is the normal behavior for a mastering monitor because you are creating content on it, not reviewing content that's been created on another brighter mastering display. Specific to the Sony BVM-HX310, you grade up to its limit of 1000 nits. You don't ask it to simulate a brighter mastering monitor by tone mapping it down. Screen uniformity on our review sample was very clean considering it's an LCD-based display with no banding, the discrete effect or color tinting on full-field gray slides. Dark uniformity was superior to OLED, with no sign of thin vertical streaks at all. Our camera managed to capture and exaggerate some vignetting on above black slides, but in actual viewing, it's negligible. There's no motion interpolation on board, so motion resolution on this horizontally scrolling test pattern came in at a sample and hold baseline of 300 lines, which isn't a problem at all on such a small screen. Slow panning shots in 24p films were handled smoothly without any sign of telecinetic judder, as you can see in this sequence from Wall-E. The true 10-bit panel drive ensured that gradation, such as the sky in The Martian, remained smooth. Interestingly, the Sony BVM-HX310 resolves full chroma at all times on this chroma bandwidth pattern from the old Spears & Munsell disc. In case any colorist fancy using this monitor for playing games during coffee breaks, input lag measured a super responsive 17 milliseconds, essentially only one frame of latency. Last but not least, we measured power consumption, and the Sony BVM-HX310 drew around 200 watts in 100 nit SDR mode, going up to 335 watts in HDR mode. And this is only a 31-inch screen. We can only guess that the baseline power consumption is so high because of the dual-layer LCD, presenting a challenge for larger consumer televisions using similar technology to pass the strict energy laws in the US and Europe. In conclusion, the Sony BVM-HX310 is a capable replacement for the now-discontinued X300. I get very much the same sense of awe when watching all types of content, and I kept saying to myself, I've never seen this footage look this good. For example, this sushi demo loop that's playing on the monitor, it's only SDR. I've never seen this level of pop from any consumer televisions I've tested, and I've tested all the high-end ones over the years. The key advantages of the HX310 over the X300 are 1. The HX310 is not limited by ABL and can output 1000 nits full screen. 2. There's no risk of OLED screen burn. And 3. The near blacks are cleaner. However, viewing angles are worse than the X300. And on a personally subjective level, the X300 still has a marginally more organic and magical look. Maybe it's the pixel contrast, maybe it's the viewing angle, maybe it's all in my head. You never forget your first love and all. It's a moot point anyway, since Sony is no longer making the X300. Speaking more broadly, dual-layer LCD or light-modulating cell layer is the most promising display technology I've seen that can rival OLED right now. Micro-LED is too far out, and the first mini-LED prototypes still exhibit some blooming. And I look forward to seeing more dual-layer LCD TVs at the consumer level if they don't fall foul of energy regulations. If you found this video useful, please click the like button and subscribe to the HDTV Test YouTube channel for more videos like this. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.